Hello everyone, my name is Nicola, I'm from Italy. I do a lot of stuff, I've been working in this field for a few years, but anyway, the only thing that matters for you is that I still have fun coding. I'm a coder after all, and I'm here to talk to you about one of my open source projects. This is called Cerberus. It's a lightweight and extensible data validation library for Python. So, data validation. In my case, I needed something to validate the data coming in from a REST API framework which I was building. And in a REST API framework, or in general, in any kind of input, you have data to validate. And in REST, it is even worse because every endpoint of your API probably has to deal with different kind of data. So you might have invoices coming at one endpoint, and customers and people, and every kind of data has its own rule to validate and stuff like that. So we needed something that could kind of avoid hard coding checks and guards for every kind of data coming in. And this is where Cerberus came in, and then we released it as an open source tool. So it's open source, of course, it is lightweight, it has no dependencies, it works on all kinds of Python, PyPy include, and you can go on GitHub and contribute if you want to. So let's give a look at this tool. It is very simple, or hopefully so. So you basically define a schema. Schema is just a dictionary, a Python dictionary. In this case, we are every key is a field that you want to validate, and then you have a mapping with the rules for the key for the field. So in this game, in this case, we have name field which is of type string, and then you have the validator. And you pass the document you want to be validated to the validator, and in this case, of course, it is very simple. Name is a string, and so it returns true. This is a complete snippet, so as you can see, it is very simple to use, and the concept is just a mapping with the schema and then the document to validate against the schema. So let's see a more complex case. Here we have name and age. Age is an integer, but it also only allows values over 10. So the first document here is rejected because it doesn't comply with the rule. And you can inspect the errors property to know what is actually the reason why the document was rejected in a human readable format, so to speak. And in Cerberus, unknown fields are rejected by default. So in this case, if we pass a sex field which is unknown, you get an error, of course. But you can set an option to actually allow unknown fields, which can be very useful in certain situation and use cases. So here we have this unknown field, which is okay, which is allowed. You see that sex now it passes the check. What is even more interesting, in my opinion, is that you can set a schema to validate against for unknown fields. So yes, I want unknown fields, but I also want them to match certain rules. So in this case, they must all be strings or they will be rejected. And you can do the same thing for nested mappings as well. So here we have a field which is called adict, or type dictionary, of course, and you are allow unknown fields, but only within this nested document. The main document will not accept any kind of unknown field. And here you have the example. So the edict field has an unknown field which is allowed. But if we had an unknown field to the main root document, it is rejected. And there are a few helper methods. For example, here this validated method allows you to only get a document if it has been validated. So here you see a simple code that basically gets a list of valid documents. You pass a number of documents to a validator, and you get back a list of valid documents, or the others are just discarded because you only need the valid ones in this use case, this example. There is also a normalized method which allows you to transform in some way the document which is coming in. This could be useful in many situations. So here we have a rule that we will see later coerce, and so the amount is you see in the example, we are passing a string in the, for the amount field, a one, but it is wrapped into, it is basically a string. The normalized method will transform that value in a one integer. So you can kind of apply corrections to the input fields on the fly as they come in. Let's see some validation rules, basic types of course, so type checking, here we are defining a string. We can actually allow more than one type for the same field, so here we are allowing string and lists, and you have regex validation, which is very nice, so you want to check an email field, you can do that, or any other kind of regex matching that you feel fancy doing. And there are also allowed values, which is very common, so you have a field which can only accept some kind of values, some certain values actually, you can just give Cerberus a list of valid values for that field, and it will take care of accepting or rejecting invalid values. As you can see, the errors property will always give you a reason why it failed. You can see why this is useful. For example, in my case, my REST API, when it rejects a payload, it sends back to the client not only the error, but something has gone wrong, but also why it went wrong, so that the client can react. Another interesting rule is dependencies. So this allows basically to only accept a field if other fields are included in the payload. So in this example, field 2 is not required, as you can see, but it depends on field 1. So in the first example, field 1 is accepted. In the second example, field 2 is rejected because field 1 is missing. And you can, of course, have value-restricted dependencies. So not only field 1 must be present, but it must be some values, similar to the allowed property we saw earlier. And here you have an example where field 1 has a value, but it is not valid for field 2 to be accepted in this payload. And then there are excludes, for example. So if a first field here is present, we don't want a second field, vice versa in this example. So the first document is accepted, but the second, the first document is rejected because both fields are present, but and the other two are accepted. There is also an option to exclusive or. Here you can see the same example as before, but an empty document is rejected because the two fields are also flagged as a required. Quindi one of the two rules must be accepted and valid. So you can see you can have a lot of options to decide with what kind of document can be accepted. Oh, here there are lists of excludes, which is basically the same example. And then there are sub-documents. This is very important because many times you don't have very simple documents. Many times you are dealing with complex documents. My use case, for example, is invoices. So I'm getting an invoice and also list, which also includes at least one list of sub-documents, which are the invoice items. And invoice items are themselves a very complex document with calculations, valid values, SQ numbers, VAT values, and stuff like that. You can validate the sub-documents in a dictionary, but also in a, as you can see here, in a list. This is the most basic example in a list. You just say, I only want integers here, or whatever else, but you can also have a list which is built of dictionaries, and you can define the schema for your dictionaries within the list. So here we have a document which has a rows field, which is a list of dictionaries, so every single dictionary within the list will be checked against your rule set. And then you can add more power using all these rules, all off, any off, etc. I'm going fast because we don't have a lot of time, but here you can see that any off allows you to define exclusive rules, or in this case, inclusive rules. So here we have a number which can be between 0 and 10 or between 100 and 110. So the first two examples here are accepted, but when we try to submit a document which has a value which is outside of the two ranges of rules, it gets rejected. And you can, of course, also use the other options, like non-off, one-off, any-off. Now, these rules apply almost everywhere in Cerberus. So, for example, here we are using any-off combined with the type rule. This is where it gets kind of interesting or fun, because here I'm saying, basically, I accept type string or integer anyway. Whatever of the two will be valid is just a shortcut for the rule that you see below here. And you can, for example, use these for actually accepting multiple schemas. So here we have not a dictionary for the schema, but we have a list with the two schemas, which are very similar, but there are some subtle differences. And when you validate your document, when you build the rule for this kind of document, the employee can be one of these schemas, so you can validate a multiple kind of document basically with the same validator instance, and this can be pretty powerful. And this rule, as you can see, this validator also accepts unknown values for the employee field. The example below is basically back getting a list of invalid phone numbers, because in this case we only want to send back the invalid data. Okay, we already saw there are a lot more rules, of course, that you can imagine. Some of them, we saw them, required, nullable, forbidden, read-only, etc. You can also validate the keys of the document, so they can only be strings, they can only be just certain values, whatever. There is also, this is very very powerful. People have been asking for this for a while, and by the way, Cerberus 1.0 stable has been released like maybe 10 days ago. So there is so if any of you have been using the previous versions, there are some breaking changes, and but they are very well worth it. One of them is this one. Now you can have a schema registry, which basically allows you to do tricks like this. You know, when the documents get bigger and bigger, you often have rules that keep repeating, and you don't want to rewrite these rules every time for every field. For two reasons. First is speed serialization. If you have to send these rules across the wire, for example, you don't want a huge validation document rule set. You want that as small as possible. So you basically just build, import the schema registry, you add your a rule. For in this case, we have this user, which has a UID value and some rules for these fields. For this field, and then you see that when we are building the schema for our documents to be validated, we say the schema for sender is user and the schema for receiver is user. So basically, here we are saying we are getting two users, and as long as they match these rules, everything else will be valid, because we are also allowing the unknown. Okay. Let's see the normalization, because another thing that a lot of people need to... Yes? Okay. So I'm going... It is better like this? Yeah. Sorry. I didn't want to lose the voice when I was turning around, but it's fine. I will just look at the monitor and we'll be fine. So here we can... Oh, great. Powerful means. Okay, so here we are renaming a field, and this is very can be necessary, and people have been asking for the ability not only to validate but also to transform data, or to change data on the fly, and maybe correct
mistakes on the fly. Instead of rejecting the document, we kind of try to fix it and accept it anyway. We will see a few tricks now. So here we are saying the field foo should be renamed to bar. And you see the example below. And you can also add custom handlers for this. So basically, you can attach a function to this feature. And then when you see here that when the field gets in, it is transformed, converted into an integer on the fly. So all the keys coming in as a string will become integers, for example. And you can even have a pipeline of transformations on your field. So here we have a field which on the key, sorry, the key is one integer, but once it is normalized, it becomes a string of two characters, because this lambda here is just making sure that the key has two characters. And then we first transform that one from an integer to a string, and then we apply the lambda, the function, and so we get a 0, 1. So you can pipe multiple transformation one after another. You can, of course, get rid of a known field. This is another way to not reject the document, but just get rid of what I don't know. And so the document gets purged, and you only get the document the field that you need. And there are default values, of course, which you can set. I believe we are close to the end, so I will skip something. Custom setters, these are pretty fun. You can, for example, in this case, for field B, we are setting a default. You see that the document coming in the key is a string, and we are basically adding a new field. And the value for the field is the 1 plus the value of the A field. So basically, we are transforming, adding documents, basing the values on the other keys in the same document. This can be pretty powerful. For example, if you have read-only fields, calculated fields, you could calculate them as the document comes in and add them to the document. We already saw coers. Here we can basically transform the document as the field value as it comes in. And very quickly, you can. All of these, you basically get it for free. It comes with the tool, but you can extend, build your own custom rules. For example, here we are adding an isOdd rule. Which then, once you have created this rule, you can use it in whatever document you want. It is just a matter of subclassing the main validator and building your own rule. As you can see here, you just add the validate prefix to your rule. And here, basically, we are rejecting documents which have an amount which is not odd. You can do the same with data types. For example, in my case, my REST API uses MongoDB as a data store. We are accepting the object ID values. They are not natively supported by Cerberus, but I can just add a new type. And when an object ID field comes in, I can validate it without any issue. So you can build the values for VAT numbers or checkers for whatever kind of strange value you're dealing with. And you can even have custom functions applied to your validation. Here it is the same example that we saw with the isOdd rule. Here we are defining an oddity function, and then we say the amount field is validated by the oddity function. So you can basically do whatever you want with during validation with your fields. And the same with coers. Here we are a super powerful validator which not only transforms the incoming field, but it also accepts the multiplier for the field. So it is just, you know, just to let you see, understand what kind of feature you can build in your if you need to, basically, by subclassing the validator and building custom rules and custom methods and whatever you want to do. And here we have another example with the default rule. We are building a default setter where we call it a UTC now. So the date field will be, if is missing will become a UTC now. And the beauty of this is that, of course, when you give this validator to anyone in your organization, you just have to say, hey, there is this really UTC now. You just say that this field is this type, has this default value, and you're done. You don't have to rebuild this rule and this transformation every time. And here there is a little trick that people have been using with Cerberus. They are validating user objects, so not native dictionaries or mappings, but as you probably know in Python, classes have dictionaries behind them. So every property and value of a class is actually stored in a dictionary. So you can build your object validator, which just passes the class dictionary to the under the hood, of course, the class dictionary to the validator. And here you see an example where we have this method, custom method validator object. We pass a person and we get an error if the person is not right. The age value in this case is not correct. And this is just a basic example, but I have a blog post on my site if you want to do something fancy with custom objects and data validation uses Cerberus. And Cerberus has been used for a while by many companies, interesting companies. This is Git Prime, for example. Some of you might know Vincent because he's the guy behind, for example, Git Flow, which is a very common Git flow. And it's been around for a while. He's a super nice guy, and he wanted to contribute with this testimonial about the project. And basically, that's it. If you want to check out Cerberus, there is a website, pythonserberus.org. You can get in touch with me. This is my Twitter handle, website, email, and the slides for this talk, they are on my website already. So you can go look at them, because I realized that we went really fast, so maybe you didn't catch everything, so I apologize for that, and thank you.
I was going to say, I think we have time for one quick question, so whoever gets their hand in the air fastest, but you beat me to it before I'd even said it.
Hey, this looks like a great library.
Thank you.
Absolute use case in my company. Are there any sort of options in pipeline for serializing schemas into like JSON or YAML? Or
well, that's really easy. Once you get the document inside, you just have to pass it to the JSON library, which is into the standard library. So the Python, the JSON package. And so that's actually what I'm doing with my REST API framework. Data comes in as JSON, and I send it to MongoDB as JSON. So that's actually the reason why Cerberus is validating dictionaries, because dictionaries and JSON in Python are basically the same thing.
And it handles all the type sort of declarations.
Yeah.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I think we've run out of time now, so if you have any further questions for Nicola, you're going to have to grab him warmly and form an orderly queue at the back of the room.
Okay, catch me offline.
Thank you very much indeed.